You all right, mate?
Yeah, not I'm hot.
Yeah, horrible, horrible weather. Yeah.
If you're watching this in a year's time, you should be able to place roughly in history where this one was recorded, just basically by the perspiration and lack of energy that we may have today.
Yeah, because it's nasty out there. My computer's saying it's 26 degrees out there at the moment,
Youch.
and that's at 7 o'clock at night. Which, yes,
Yes.
far too hot. Yes. Yeah, I blame Greta Thunberg.
Hang on, I don't know if I can compute that. You blame Greta Thunberg for being too hot?
Almost certainly not. That's definitely not what I was saying there. Yeah. And yeah, you can rewind that. And unless he's fucked with the edit at some point, yeah, I
After
didn't.
the haiku I heard you deliver on Monday, I don't think anything's off the table, to be perfectly honest.
I was kind of pleased with that one. Yeah, that was yeah, I didn't realize I could upset so many people with 17 syllables.
It was amazing. It was amazing. We're
Yeah.
not going to do it right now. We
No.
may do a special of really sick and twisted haikus. I think that's quite an
Yes.
idea to do. And we can just spend half an hour writing really sick and twisted haikus, but that's going to be one. Definitely.
Yes, it would have to be. Yes. Yeah. Ah, yeah, that was good on
Anyways, let me
that.
ask Ash. Oh
Yes.
dearest Ash, oh darling Ash, what have we been reading this week?
This week, we have been reading ABO by Walter Delamere. Do you want a synopsis?
Oh, please.
What's my synopsis gone? Come here, synopsis. Synopsis, right. So, ABO is a Walter Delamere monster story, which is a very, very rare thing. Walter Delamere, I can't actually read his name without going through that song of Walter Delamere. But yeah, completely. Anyway, it's a monster story, which is rare for him because normally he was into poetry, and it was originally published under the name of Walter Rilam Marlowe.
Rumbelow, I think it was.
So, story itself starts properly when our narrator, Pelother, or Pelutha, receives a letter from his friend Dugdale. Now, there is an interaction with a young boy, which was just fucking irritating, so I'm not going to go into that. But the letter, am I wrong there, Colin?
Well, we'll talk about that. Get the synopsis, and we can go into all of the different moments throughout this tale.
He gets a letter saying, "Dear friend Pell, I'm writing in a fever. Come at once. Antiquities. Come at once, or I begin without you." So consequently, Pelutha goes at once to help his antiquarian pal dig up something nasty in the garden. And yeah, to directly quote from the story, when he again set to work upon the chest, he prized open the lid at the first effort. The scrap of broken steel rang upon the metal of the chest. A faint and unpleasant odor became perceptible. Dugdale, that's the friend who's called him, yeah, remained in the position. The sudden lift of the lid had given his body, his head bent slightly forward over the open chest. I put one hand upon the side of the chest. My fingers touched a little cake of hard stuff. I looked into the chest. I took a step forward and looked in. Yellow cotton wool lined the leaden sides and was thrust into the interstices of the limbs of the creature which sat within. So, Dugdale and Pelutha decided best to bury whatever it is they found, but they agreed to do it the following night. Then, through some detail that people who'd paid attention to the story would have followed, the monster from the chest gets reanimated and inhabits Pelutha's house rather than Dugdale's. Then Pelutha invites a caretaker to join him, but the caretaker says no, even though he's sort of like offered a few quid. And then Pelutha invites a beggar into his home, gives him some food. They both see the monster, that's not a euphemism, as it escapes the house. Then Pelutha goes to Dugdale's house and Dugdale explains that the creature has escaped. And he does this in a way that makes Pelutha think he's mad. Then it got to the end and the story was over.
Yeah, that's the one I read.
Yeah, I appreciate that's not the most succinct or erudite synopsis, but
It was more like one of my synopsises, to be perfectly honest with
a lot of the time I was thinking, well, what the fuck's happened? How's this happened? What, where, why are we here? Why are we here? Why is this farming here? And but yeah, what do you think to it?
I've got three different answers.
Okie
One, I thought it was
dokie. Three
rubbish.
different answers. Fuck off, piss off. Don't do
So,
that
one,
again.
I thought it was utter rubbish.
Yeah.
But two, I found it thoroughly entertaining.
Right.
And three, what is my answer to that one? It's just a question, answering a question with a question, like what? Because it didn't make any sense at all. So do I need to? I need to qualify a bit here, don't I?
Yeah, please go on.
I'll start with the qualification of the second one of finding it thoroughly entertaining. I, as you know, am quite drawn towards purple prose. I quite like them. I like really over the top flowery stuff because it makes me laugh, and I find it entertaining that people in a bit like, from Buffy the Vampire Slayer when Spike was a poet back in the old days.
Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of thing of being completely ridiculously over the top and romantic for no reason whatsoever. And I found the language of this was exactly that. It gave me ridiculous prose about things, which I thoroughly enjoyed. What I thought was rubbish is I have absolutely no idea how the plot was running at all. I kept, even though I listened to it and I read it, and I kept losing where I was in the whole thing, because there were so many things that were just thrown in a very surreal way, which I like surrealism, don't get me wrong, which is probably why I also enjoyed it, even though I thought it was rubbish. Like the pipe that comes out of the trunk, right?
Yeah.
That goes off into a tree. And it's like, so why, what is it there for? Is it to release the gas from a rotting corpse, or is it so that it can breathe? And then never go back to it.
Yeah.
They just cut it and that's it. They just cut it with a saw. Well, let's go and get a saw. And they go hand in hand to go and get the saw. And then, because he doesn't trust him to not open the box without him or whatever. That I found really odd. And like you say, the opening exchange with the boy at the door was kind of like, I thought this was supposed to be. To be brutally honest with you, I thought it was older than what it was, actually, in the way that
Yeah.
it was written, because I thought surely he would have just clipped the kid round the ear and not given him a sixpence and just taken the bloody letter off it by force. And then you actually find out that actually it's not as old as it you think it is. It's like 1920 or something like that, the story was written.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's mixed feelings.
Yeah, you've raised a couple of really interesting points there. The language, I mean, at one point when he's talking to this child, he says, "I said somewhat pedagogically," and it's just, why the fuck are you throwing that word in there? But also, it threw in the word reft, which I'd only encountered the word reft before in the bereft, as in somebody sort of like bereft of something, they've had it stolen away from them. So yeah, that was kind of a new one on me. So yeah, he's obviously got a poet's drive for language, but yeah, the whole thing was incredibly fucking confused and confusing. And yeah, that first interaction that we've got with that little lad turns up, and he's got a letter for Mr. Palutha. And Mr. Palutha is doing the whole thing of, oh well, who's the letter from? Why? What do you want from him? And the lad is being evasive, but it just goes nowhere. It doesn't give us any suggestion of what the character of the narrator is like. It doesn't, the young lad doesn't appear again within this story. All that he is a messenger, and it's just, it seems like a pointless and unnecessary distraction.
But I think the author, I think Mr. Walter Delamere, Mr. Delamere, was actually trying to create character in that scene. I think that's what he was attempting to do and failing badly. That's
Yeah.
really, yeah, because it's the whole interaction, like you say, it's a bit like I get phone calls, as we all get phone calls from large amounts of people that don't know us. And they will always say, "Is that Mr. Davis?" And of course, my first response is, "Who's calling?"
Yeah.
Because I want to know if this is one of those multiple submissions I've sent off phoning me. Is this Steven Spielberg's PA trying to get through? Or is it just someone trying to find out if I've had an accident in the last 5 years?
It wasn't
That's
your fault.
Yeah, that wasn't my fault. Yeah,
Exactly.
and well, actually, telling me to half the time they're not asking me if I've had one; they're telling me I've had an accident. That's half the time is what they're saying. But that's what this guy's doing. So you get this Scroat at the door and says, I got this for Mr. You know, Tallulah. I'm going to call him Tallulah because that's all that goes through my head. Every time it says Palalula, I just think of Bugsy Malone and the song, My Name is Palalula, like that. So, yeah, he's got this kid at the door and he's doing the whole I'm just checking. And then it kind of almost tries to turn into a comedy skit, almost trying to be the two Ronnies before the two Ronnies were about by doing this kind of, who's calling? Well, I've been told to give him this in his hand. He said, well, I'm him. And then he won't give it to him. So he pays him to get the actual letter that's supposed to be handed into his hand by hiding behind the door and leaving sixpence on the step. So I kind of get the idea that he's trying to show that this man is not evil and nasty and kind of a little bit playful. And no, it didn't come across that way.
Suppose one of the things also that's done in that scene is that it borders on racism, but the lad accuses him of being a coward by whistling the French national anthem.
Yes.
And I think we're trying to get the idea that a little bit like Marty McFly in Back to the Future 2 and 3, you accuse him of being a coward and it's sort of like rankles and gets his back up. And yeah, we're sort of like seeing that from Tallulah Palula, where, yeah, the accusation of cowardice doesn't sit well with the character. But I do think it was a very, very overblown, and I mean, that took up about the first 10 minutes of the recording.
Mm.
And for nothing, just to give us this idea that this bloke doesn't like to be perceived as a coward.
Well, ending up being nothing, because that's the strange thing about a scene like this, isn't it? Because yeah. When it was going on in the opening 10 minutes, it was actually quite intriguing. You've got this really sort of strange stuff going on, and you're thinking, okay, right, so we've got an urchin from the streets in good old Edwardian London, and therefore, you know, we've got it's trying to set in, you know, my scheme martyr is going, it's dirty, there's horse carriages going on outside. I particularly like the fact that he described it as a four-wheeled carriage rather than just a hansom cab, which I thought was quite an unusual description. But it didn't go anywhere. And it's sort of like, and it ends up becoming annoying because you're trying to think of how that's now going to play out in the rest of the story, and it never comes back. So it's a distraction, even though it's in when it first happens, it's like, oh, okay, where are we going? And then it just disappears, you know, and you can't get it out of your head, the fact that this, because it has an interesting dichotomy about it.
Yeah.
But has no story about it. And so the character never develops along that line. The boy never comes back. The letter is inconsequential. And it just falls away. And you're like, oh, why have you done that?
Yeah, why have you started it at this fucking point here? Why didn't you sort of like start it 6 or 1,000 words into the story?
Yeah, I think he just wanted to describe. I really genuinely think he wrote a description about a doorbell going off and the way that it kind of lingers. Because that was beautiful. I love the way I looked over my book at the sound of this bell being rung. Yeah. And he'd written that and thought that was brilliant. Oh, my God, it's one of the best things he's ever written. And then had to tack a scene onto the end of why he had done that. Because, again, this beautiful overwritten description of the bell ringing is probably the most beautiful description in the whole of the story.
Fully agree, yeah. So then it starts getting, well, no, not then. From there, the story moves on to Tallulah Palula meets up with Dugdale, who is, Dugdale is digging, and digging up a box in his back garden.
Yes.
Which, again, you've had this intriguing opening. You've introduced a character who's not really important, but for a minor little bit of character development to your narrator, you've got this huge fucking clumsy thing of, oh, there's buried treasure in my back garden. We've had this long. It would be like if I said, Col, come round to mine. Although I've lived in this house for 20 years, I've discovered that there's something in the back garden. About midnight-ish, let's dig there, shall we? In which case, you would be sort of, your first thought would be, it's taking you 20 years to find this out, has it? It just seems a little bit too nichey and convenient.
Yes.
Yeah, that happens to the best of us. So they dig up. What do we think ABO was? Are we going with the heavy-handed clues that were daubed in the writing?
Well, to me, it was abomination. As soon as I thought, there's going to be a monster in the box. You know, it's everything about it was it's a monster in the box. This isn't an evil spirit coming out because we've got that strange pipe. But like you say, he'd lived there for 20 years and hadn't seen this pipe sticking out of the tree. So I was thinking abomination. I was sort of looking at it going abomination, and then the heavy-handed thing sort of like landed, and I thought, oh, they've got to be careful. It'll be banned in America, this.
Yeah. Yeah, it's sort of like
But it does mean that I haven't done it yet because I've been busy today. But I do need to look up the original word abortion to find out what it meant at the time of that story being read.
Yeah, because he talks about it as though it's a leprous abortion, as though it's an abortion from somebody who's got leprosy, or yeah, it was again not particularly clear. And I'm not going to say that that's the fault of Walter de la Mare. That's probably history that sort of like has moved us away from original meanings and things like that.
Yes. I
But
think it, I think the meaning was abomination. I think the idea was that what was in there was something that was, what do they call it? It's a slight to God, isn't it? That it's
right.
this thing that is not human, that is not humanity, that is the embodiment of evil, that is an affront to God himself. And that's kind of where the time, abominations are that kind of thing. And I think the word abortion in this context is meaning that.
Yeah, I think it's nice also that whether it's an abortion or an abomination, it's nice that we label our boxes with that. It's a shame that the print didn't stay on a little bit more. Which I suppose it depends what you're actually using to put it on there. If it's like gold leaf or something like that, it's not going to stay on, is it?
Well, it was daubed on, wasn't it? They said actually, I think it daubed on and rubbed off by the clay, and it's like, but obviously, apart from the fact that it was ABO was there, ABO was going on, because there was always the possibility it was, it's lucky that it wasn't written in Australia, wouldn't it? Because they would have just looked at it and gone, oh, there's an ABO in there, bury it
Yeah,
again.
it's this monstrous creature with
Yes, which oozes evil. Yeah, absolutely oozes evil. To the point, like you say about the caretaker, he scuffles over the fence to talk to this guy who won't even come out of his house because he can feel the evil.
which is I mean, yeah, you've got the caretaker who's who doesn't want to go in, which again was a pointless interaction.
Yes.
He made nothing out of the fact that he was offering him a fiver and then a tenner,
£20 at the end.
which is a lot of money nowadays. Back then would have been an incredible amount of money. But yeah, we've got those parts that are sort of like brushed over, and then we get the beggar.
Yes. Which again was one of those kind of things of sort of like, come and stay with me. Because
Yeah,
that's, I mean,
that creeps up.
I love the old way of talking about it. Come sup with me. And he kept saying, come sup with me. And my mind's going like modern day double entendre mental case going on, right? When I think he's either meaning come supper with me, or he's, at one point he does say come sit with me, but a lot of it's come sup with me. So it's either supper or drink beer or something like that, I think. But he kept on doing it. Go on, I'll pay you a fiver. Just come sup with me. Give me a £5 note. Go, come sit
I
with
need
me.
to, yeah. And again, this is confusion on my part. And I've listened to this 3 times now, 2.5 times of which were today. And my confusion is The box gets dug up in Dugdale's backyard. That's not a euphemism. Dugdale keeps hold of the box and they say, all right, we're going to bury it again tomorrow night, because Dugdale's a little bit cream-crackered and doesn't want to sort of like, yeah. And then this monster thing is appearing in Tulapalula's house.
Yes.
Why?
I've given this some thought.
Right.
When it first happened, there was a kind of like, well, why have you come here? Right.
Yeah.
But all I can think is that it's kind of like, you know, it's peeled itself off the yellow nicotine ridden cotton wool. Right.
Right.
Well, it might just be iodine, mightn't it? That they tried to, you got this kind of strange abomination creature and they tried to cure it just by rubbing some iodine on it or whatever. Right.
Could be stigma.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could just be piss.
Yeah.
But the so it's peeled itself out of this casket, for want of a better word. The bloke sat there and gone, oh my god, you're hideous. Here's my mate's address, go and frighten him.
Right, I'm not saying that that didn't happen. I'm not saying that that's not what happened. What I am saying is, if I was creating a story and that happened, the reader would know about it rather than having to chat with his friend who's guessed about it and then is suggesting that as an idea.
Yeah, it makes... That's me really trying to shoehorn something into this. Because plot-wise, it's just all over the place.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah. Plot-wise, it's not. And that's what I was saying about the differences. Because... I'm actually still enjoying the descriptions. I'm enjoying the descriptions of the evil. I'm enjoying the descriptions of the beggar not being able, you know, trying to eat, even though he is completely terrified. His hunger outweighs his fear. And, and he hasn't even seen the creature to be that terrified. He could just feel it. And the caretaker next door, who for some reason I saw as Eric Sykes, so like peering out and not wanting to get involved until he looks through the window and then he's off, you know, and I'm done with this. And I love the way it was described. It was so over the top and really kind of flowery and, you know, and I thought that was really, really good, but it sort of like makes no sense whatsoever. It's just, it was like watching a really, really terrible B movie on the Sci-Fi channel. That's been made for like £400, but still really enjoying that bird thing, what was it called, Birdmageddon or something like that, right?
Birdemic,
that's it, right? Yeah. Which is just dreadful. I've seen better Christmas plays at a primary school.
Yeah.
But it's really enjoyable because of it being so over the top in the way it's done. And actually, the other one's The Room, isn't it?
The Room is wonderfully dreadful.
Yeah.
The making of The Room is fantastic. Birdemic 2. Have you seen that one?
I haven't seen Birdemic 2. I don't even have to worry. I think, has he gone 3D with that one or something like that? Has he got a bit more money for his... Has he worked out how to use After Effects a bit better?
He was going to go 3D with Birdemic 3. Which would have been Birdemic 3D. I don't know whether that happened or whether COVID spared us from that. saved.
But that's what I was reading. I was reading something that was absolutely the story, the plot line, the way that the plot actually worked was terrible. It just was. It's not like a test piece, though. It felt like at times it felt like a. Stream of consciousness going on, but it actually had too many scene points to be a stream of consciousness, if you know what I mean. They're like going to see the caretaker was a completely separate scene,
yeah,
rather than something that flowed from one to the other. So it's almost like he had ideas where he wanted to go but never really thought about how you get from one to the other.
It was reminding me of in Good Omens by Pratchett and Gaiman.
Yes.
The main character is a little boy called Adam, who he's meant to be. We don't know whether he's the. In fact, I think we do know. He's the Antichrist, the son of the devil, but he's been brought up just as a regular lad.
Yes.
And he's got a regular little boy's imagination for things. And he's talking about a book that he's written, which has got sort of like dinosaurs in it and spaceships, and there's a love interest and pirates, and and several World War II scenes. And it's almost 3 pages long, he says. And yeah, it's just that's what we had there. There were all these things that were just thrown in, all these different tropes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I actually wonder when it got to the point where it actually goes, this abortion, that's what it meant. ABO, abortion. It was almost as bad, not quite as bad, as the film adaptation of The Half-Blood Prince when it reveals who the Half-Blood Prince is at the end, where it's almost like the scriptwriter's gone, shit, we forgot to do any Half-Blood Prince stuff. Oh yes, I'm me. It's me. It's the, then goes off. And it was a little bit like it was so, like you say, heavy-handed in the way that it was done. But by that point, that was almost like a jolt in that it's almost like he's writing and gone, oh, fuck, I haven't done anything to do with that. Quick, put it in the middle of another scene. Oh, it was so disjointed. It really was. But I couldn't help but smile when I was listening to it.
I mean, there's things in there that I really like. I love the idea of digging something up and then finding out that something evil has escaped. That's such an exciting story idea. And I like the idea of something infesting or inhabiting someone's house. I think, again, that's got echoes that can really, really work within a piece of fiction. And all these things where people are brought into proximity with this evil and are then frightened by it, and yeah, we get to experience their fright again. Those were good things, but they were just so confident. It was like looking at a jigsaw puzzle that's been made up from pieces from different boxes.
Actually, do you know what I think it's like?
Go
It's like if you think about, do you remember Word 97?
on. Yes,
And clip it coming
yes.
up. And clip it coming up and saying, I can see you're trying to write a H.P. Lovecraft. Would you like some help with that?
Yes. Yeah, completely.
Because even the end of it, when his mate's gone mad, it's in the wrong order. He should have, the whole thing should more be. Maybe if I tried using English correctly as well. Should more be. My
Yeah.
brain's gone mad. If you think about it this way, let's take that story. Like you say, it's got some really nice tropes in it, and things buried. I love the pipe. I thought the pipe was excellent. That's why it was annoying that it didn't do anything. Just cut it. So what a great idea that this thing's actually been breathing.
Yeah.
So let's go with let's just change the order of it. They've dug it up. They've done the usual Edwardian Victorian thing of, oh, can't be bothered with this right now. Let's deal with it tomorrow and let it climb out of its box, right? Big. They always make that mistake. So, but now let's swap it round. Let's swap it to he goes back to Digbeth's the next day and finds the guy mad and insane and completely out of it, but still finds the thing in the box like it hasn't moved. So he thinks his mate's gone mad from a dream about this mummified abortion in the box. And then it follows him home to his house. And then he's in his house and this thing has come and followed him. And he suddenly realizes at that point, he starts feeling things are bad and now he just feels the need to have someone with him. So he tries to get the caretaker who won't go in because he, well, you can't pay me enough to go in there. It feels so bad. And then he gets the beggar in. And it's at the time when the beggar's in that he suddenly realizes and he sees the figure himself as being in that room with him. And that's why the feeling is so bad. And that's when he realizes that his mate wasn't mad after all. And that this thing has now followed him home after the second visit.
Fully agree. The only bit that I would have added to that is rather than him thinking, oh, me mate's mad, I'm gonna go home, it would be a case of, oh, me mate's mad, this box, something needs to be done with this, best if I take that with me back to my house. And
Yeah.
yeah, that way you've got it sort of like carried across there. But other than that, yeah, it was so it was the right story but in the wrong order.
But in the wrong order, yeah.
Yeah, which yeah, it's frustrating really, isn't it?
Well, it is, and it is. It's one of those sort of strange things. It's one, it's frustrating because you're sitting down to read these stories and trying to enjoy them. And like I say, it was quite enjoyable for a reason. for a certain amount, but it wasn't an absolute classic because of what we've just been talking about. And I think in those orders, it would be right up there with the M.R. James's, I think, as being, sort of great ways of telling spooky tales. But also, it's not, because I think the ability to be able to take something and go, funny enough, as you know, I'm mad into adaptations at the moment, looking at adaptation theory. And I think it's a great, adaptations are a great way of breaking something down and analyzing it in a different way. So I think taking something that isn't quite right, and then piecing it back together in the right order can then influence and go, I tell you what, I'm going to write a similar story to that now because we've now got that and put it in and let's see if it works. And you can come up with something that can be a really good spooky tale because I don't believe completely in originality. I really don't. I was reading a list the other day that are supposed to be the five main things of creativity, and number one was originality. And I thought, no, it's not. One of the main things about creativity is adaption, the ability to take influences and adapt them into what you want to do.
Absolutely, yeah. If where would we be without intertextuality?
Exactly.
And yeah, that's part of the reason why this one didn't work for me was because it didn't have the intertextuality of a prescribed structure.
Yes.
It had got all of these things, and I'm not just talking about the structure of I wanted to see a story that I'd seen before, but I wanted a reason for that young delivery boy to be there other
Yes.
than delivering something. If he's just delivering something, in that case, hand the letter over, then fuck off and let's
Yes.
get on with the story. Don't sort of like try and screw this guy out of sixpence and go around whistling the French national anthem just to show, oh, do you know what? We're fucking Brexitards here and we will supply peace. So, yeah, I didn't want any of that nonsense. When it comes to the pipe, as you say, you've got a pipe that's going out of this box and up into a tree. My God, why? What a brilliant, fascinating idea. Completely forgot. No, that's not how you write a story. With a story, you write it and you sort of like you give the reader everything they need step by step. And
Yes.
yeah, it was disingenuous, really. Yeah. If
I
Walter
think
Delamere was around now, I would twat the bastard.
that actually is a really, really good statement to use. It's disingenuous in what it was trying to do because it wasn't weird enough to be surreal. I like a good surreal story. I mean, I'm much prefer some of the Lovecraft stuff, the way it's written, to the way that you like things written. And I'm a bit like that with the H.G. Wells stuff as well, where it becomes surreal because it becomes so, you put uber reality on top of something else and it becomes incredibly surreal rather than just a straightforward three act plot line. But taking that away from it's none of that. The only thing that keeps this going is the fact that it is just beautifully written prose. And it's the poetry of it that actually makes it work. Nothing else about this makes it spooky or eerie because it's all in the wrong order, and it's not surreal enough to be able to do. It does all these wonderful setups and doesn't deliver on any of the setups that it's not even surreal enough. It doesn't go off into a weird enough place for it to be considered a surreal sort of postmodernistic idea.
So our verdict here then is Walter Delamere he shouldn't quit his day job. He should go back to poetry.
If I got this, and I'm going to use this as an analogy now, and you know why. If I got this handed to me as an assessment piece, I was marking that, I would probably put it around about the C plus into a B minus.
I would be being very generous and pushing it towards the B minus because I think the quality of the writing has sort of like got, it's introduced me to some parts of language that I wouldn't have expected to encounter.
Oh, and a
But
wonderful line as well that stuck in my head, and it's so annoying because I tried to do a very quick search. I'm gonna have to go through my books. I'm gonna have to do it the old way. There's a point when he's going into Dilbert's house, and he says, "And he goes forward. He was the sexton, and I was the owl."
yes.
And I thought that was stuck because I, in the back of my head, I know there's an old folk tale about the sexton and the owl. And that I realized was a bit of intertextuality that went on there. And you know what? I can't bloody find it. I did a query only as a quick search, but all I could find was sexton owls. But I know there's a folk tale about why the owl is called the sexton owl. And I can't find it. It's so annoying. But I think that's what he's referring to.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Yeah.
It did seem to have that sort of like delivery to it. But I thought it was readable. There were parts that were entertaining, but there were parts that were really, really frustrating. And I don't read to be frustrated, I read to be entertained.
Which is why I'd say that that's like you say, it's the quality of the prose that pushes it probably towards the B minus idea, but the actual story, it fails on so many levels, from a plot, from character development, from just straightforward narrative, really. It just doesn't deliver properly on those. And doesn't even deliver experimentally either. That's why it's frustrating. Is it becomes one of those pieces where, like we're saying, when we read Dracula's Guest, there's something about it where you could say it was an experimental piece. You could tell that there was playtime going on, and you could forgive it certain elements of not delivering on the plot properly because you could see what was being tried. Here, I couldn't see what was being tried. I couldn't see what he was, bar the wonderful descriptions. There you go. It's a bunch of wonderful descriptions that have been sewn together. It's a patchwork of descriptions rather than having any coherent idea that he was playing with.
And yeah, that's not what a story should be about.
No.
A story should be about the narrative. And yeah, you do need eloquent description, you do need character building, but most important of all, you need that narrative structure to make it cohesive.
Yes, totally agree. Totally agree.
So yeah, that's me shitting on Walter Delamere this evening.
And to be brutally honest with you, why not?
Yeah.
Yes.
So what are we reading this week?
What are we reading this week? I'm going back to this lovely book here, the late night ones. We're going for what? Again, because I'm completely into adaptations at the moment. Please excuse my the way that I'm kind of doing things at the moment. Okay, so do you remember the Tales from the Unexpected?
Roald Dahl, a lot of them were based on his short story collection, Kiss Kiss.
Yes, apart from the ones that weren't.
Yes.
Yes, like Death Can Add by Philip Ketcham.
Death can add.
By Philip Ketcham.
Bill Ketchum, right.
And I'm hoping again, because I don't do, you know me, I don't do any of that kind of research malarkey like that. I'm too busy doing other research malarkey. So I'm hoping that there is an audio version of that.
I'm just about to find out now.
As I'm going to.
Right, we've got Tales of the Right, there's the Tales of the Unexpected here.
Yeah, but it's an adaptation of this. So that it there's so you've got the tale from the unexpected one there, yeah?
Yeah,
Okay.
that's available.
And it's the
Definitely.
short story that that one's based on.
Right, no, I'm not finding it immediately.
No, I think I'm gonna have to record this one. I think I actually have a book here of quite unknown stories.
Jan Francis was in it. So this is one where you're going to be recording this
I'm going to
one.
be recording this one. It's
Yes.
not overly long. But it will come. I will do a recording of this one. You watch. You'll probably find that this was actually written in the 1970s, this one, because I haven't done it. It's not a particularly long one, so we should be okay.
Giving a lot of D's in out there.
Don't worry, I'll locate it. And I, you know me, I don't care. If they want to shut down the channel, let them try.
Yeah, we'll. Brilliant stuff.
Yeah, that's great. Right, so that should be, anyway, something different, something new, and definitely something that we would not have read anywhere else. Right, that goes over there. And actually gives me an excuse to get through that book, which I've had for years.
Fantastic.
Brilliant. Well, that was a great chat. Really, really enjoyed that. I think it just sort of comes to the end of, hey, look, have a read of the story, because there is some really interesting stuff to read in terms of the way that the language is used. But also, I think, read it, just see how not to construct a story.
Yeah.
Really, I think that's but definitely read it. Don't throw things to one side because we've said it's rubbish. Give it a go. You might love it. You might read it and think it's absolutely superb. If you do, leave a comment. On the video.
Stupid for getting it wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. Call us everything. Call us anything. You know, you can use any kind of language. We don't care. Okay. I mean, there's a certain racial languages that we don't like, but apart from that, you know, something that Ina Blyton used to use on a regular basis, you know, that sort of thing, but just don't call us that, but call us anything else you want. If you think we're wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't mind. Yeah. Used to it. Yeah.
All right, Geezer.
Thanks, mate.
See you later.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye.